Well, thank you all for coming. So I've set myself quite a challenge, I think, to cover in some detail all of these different subjects in 45 minutes, but we'll see how we go. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is this interest panel, and I'm going to tell you what went into the design and what the construction is. So just move that pointer out of the way. So if you haven't been up there, and I guess you'll be up there soon, so it's next to this sort of nice little alcove with chairs for people to sit in and discuss mathematics. And it looks like this. So there's a problem with slide talks in that you can't sort of leave something on the board and see it. So just fix this in your mind, what it looks like, because we're going to be coming back to eventually construct the thing. But it's a little tricky to see how it got there. So the first thing we need to talk about are reptiles. So reptiles, not the sort of lizardy, four-legged animals. This version of reptiles are shapes that can be tiled with smaller versions of themselves. So they're tiles that can sort of reproduce themselves. So here are some simple examples. A square can be tiled with four copies of itself, or nine copies of itself, or however many you want. Same thing with triangles. Here are some more interesting reptiles, some more surprising reptiles. So this sort of, this is called a sphinx shape, can be tiled with four copies of itself. It's a trapezium, four copies of itself. This sort of L-shape, Tetris-like tile, again, four copies of itself. There's a lot of fours here, you might notice. Here's an interesting example. The isosceles right triangle can be tiled with two copies of itself. There's a different thing going on there. So here's Tetris shape, I guess, tritris, because there's only three squares here. And so you can subdivide it into four pieces, and then, of course, you can subdivide them as well. And so you can keep going and keep going and keep going, and you can do this forever if you'd like and get smaller and smaller, more complicated tilings. In some civilized parts of the world, we have paper, which is also a reptile. Not in America, sadly. I don't really know why the letter size in America is the way it is, but in England, at least, the equivalent of the letter size paper is the A4 paper. And there's all these different sizes, and so it turns out that A0 paper can be cut into two copies of A1 paper. It's the same aspect ratio, which is scaled down, and then A1 paper can be cut into two copies of A2 and so on, so that the A4 paper is also a reptile. You may be familiar with this. This is the Sierpinski triangle. So I'll just go through the construction of this if you haven't seen this before. This is a different kind of fractal. So you start out with a triangle, and we saw how you could divide a triangle into four smaller triangles. So we'll do the same thing, and we'll remove the middle triangle. And then we've got three new triangles, and so we'll do the same thing and remove the middle triangles of those. And we'll keep going and keep going and keep going and keep going and keep going. And if you do this infinitely many times, and you remove all of the middle triangles of any triangle you ever see, then this is the Sierpinski triangle. And it sort of turns into dust, because you can't actually, if I actually went further on, you wouldn't see any blue anymore. You'd just see white, because everything that the pixels of the screen will see will go away, but there's still something there. And this is it's a strange kind of reptile, because if you think about it, well, here I've colored it in this way, the whole thing is tiled by three copies of itself. And okay, so I mean, this version of it isn't, because if I actually took this and scaled it down and put it on here, then there'd be little holes in each of these triangles, because this version is sort of one level deeper than these versions. But if you go infinitely far, then that doesn't happen. You really see the same thing. So the next thing that's part of this this design is our fractal curves. So there's many of these things that people have thought about over the years. Some people may have heard of space-filling curves. This is the Hilbert curve, which was discovered by Hilbert in 1891. And there's an amazing menagerie of different sorts of curves. And I should mention, really, this is the Hilbert curve here. Again, this is a sort of iterative process. So we start with quite a simple curve, and then you make it more squiggly, and you make it more squiggly, and you make it more, and you keep going. And so really the fractal curve is when you keep doing this forever and ever and ever, then you get some sort of crazy thing which is infinitely squiggly. But I'm just going to be talking about the construction of this, so these steps as you go forward. So this is the Hilbert curve and these are the steps in the construction of the Hilbert curve. Now I'm going to explain, where does this come from? I mean, as you step forward, you say, okay, this fits very nicely together, but how would you actually design this? Why does this work? So let's look at this. So the Hilbert curve is based on, or you can think of it as being based on one of these reptiles, the reptiles with squares. So here I've got four squares, and then each of these squares is subdivided into four, and then each of those is subdivided into four. So this is two of the steps. And let me put the Hilbert curve on, drawn on top of that reptile. So what am I doing? I'm going through these squares in some order, and I'm drawing lines between the centers of those squares. And if I change the colors of these connecting bits, then you can start to see how this is constructed. So what do? We take this 2x2 square, and we're going to fit it into itself, another 2x2 square, but we're going to shrink this down and put a copy of it into one of the each of the four squares of this scaled down version. And now what I have to do is I have to decide on the orientation of that guy in each of these ones so that they're going to connect together nicely. So I've put in these cyan connectors to show how they're going to connect together. And then to get from this picture to this picture, we just do the same thing. We just take this thing, scale it down by a factor of two, and put it in these different parts, again, rotate it in the same way. So for the top two, I just scale it down and I put it in. I don't rotate it. And for these ones down, I scale it down and rotate, and I scale it down and rotate. And I do the same thing over here with these ones here. Does everybody see? It's the same construction. It's just I've taken this design and put it in here rather than this design that I put in there. And now the question is, well, why did I decide that these two weren't going to rotate and these two were going to rotate like this? And here's the trick. Here's what you need. So let me zoom in, just looking at these two. So I've put these blue dots in the corners, and these somehow are the key for why this works. So the idea is, I've got this design, and it's going to turn into a more complicated squiggly design, but what's going to happen is that I'm going to exit and enter at these corners here, and so I've put a blue dot there to say that this is going to work. So when I scale these things down and put them in, I have to get the blue dots next to each other, because otherwise I won't be able to connect them together. So let me move one step forward. So this is another possible design where I've put these in, but with different orientations. They connect together, the blue dots go together. If the blue dots weren't next to each other, then those cyan lines would be, you know, they'd be too long, they wouldn't be on the grid and so on. But, okay, this is the one that works, this is the one that doesn't. The other thing that I need, not only when I put these things in do they connect together, but also the entry and exit for this subdivided version have to be in the same corners. Because if you don't do that, something's going to go wrong the next step. So this is the one that doesn't work. So I could say, I'm going to replace this thing with this thing, but then when I try and do it again and scale it down, now these connectors are sort of in the middle of the square rather than the corners. And I guess I should have drawn a picture of this, but I didn't. If you try and do the next step, you're going to run into trouble because these things are not sort of at the corners where you can connect out to their neighbors. Anyway, so maybe go away and think about this a little bit. But there are some restrictions for what you can do. But the basic idea is you take this design, you scale it down, and you put it in so that it works. So that was the Hilbert curve. And now what is going on here with this design is there's a tiling and there's a reptiling and then there's a curve based on that reptile. So first of all, I'm going to tell you what the reptiling is. So this is based on, this is the pinwheel tiling by Radin and Conway. And so this is based on this right-angled triangle. And the lengths here, this is sort of length one, and this is length two. And so if you remember your Pythagorean theorem, you'll know that the length of the hypotenuse is the square root of 5. And surprisingly, this can be tiled with 5 copies of itself, scaled down by whatever the right factor is. So you can see here's the long non-hypotenuse side of the right triangle, and that's length 2. And so it's matching up with 2 short sides of the triangle, which are length 1. So they match together. And this is sort of an unusual tiling, right? I mean, I've got a vertex here, I've got a corner of these two triangles, which is in the middle of a long edge of another triangle. So this is a little bit strange, but there you go, it works. And as before, you can just keep going and tile all of those, and then tile all of those, and then tile all of those, and then tile all of those, and you can go on forever and then get tinier and tinier and tinier triangles. And I should mention that the reason that this was so interesting to Radin and Conway, this is the first example of a reptiling, or in fact, I think even a tiling, where as you go further into the tiling, the angles at which the tiles appear, there's infinitely many. So if I go back through some things and look at this one. So we have lots and lots and lots of tiles, but they're all aligned with the axes. They're never changing. And this, there we go. And this guy, and the reason that this is happening is that this angle here is not a nice multiple of 360 degrees. It's some irrational something. And so as you keep going, the angles at which they appear, all kinds of crazy angles. So that's why people were interested in this. I'm interested in this because I want to put a curve through this tiling. In the same way that we built the Hilbert curve, you want to build a curve that goes through this reptile. So we have to play the same sort of game. So the first thing is we want to write down a curve which is just going through the centers of the triangles in some order. Well, so there you go. There isn't really much choice in which way you're going to do this, so that because you want neighboring triangles to be consecutive in the order. So, well, this one has to be next to this one, and this one has to be next to this one. And I guess there's a choice, which way around do you go here? But it turns out that with this blue dots condition, there's only one way to do it. So this design rotated and reflected and so on, and put into this smaller version. And I've put in these little cyan connectors. And let me put in the blue dots. So it turns out I want to enter and exit at the acute angles of this triangle. And so why is that? It's because I can get the blue dots to be next to each other. So here's the acute angle here, the acute angle here. And so this is next to this triangle. So really what's happening is I'm going from acute to acute, and I'm going from acute to acute, and I'm going back down here, and then I'm going over here, and then I'm going up here. And so all of the blue dots are next to each other. It means the connectors are not long, and if your connectors are sort of away from each other, you're just going to get a long line that crashes through everything else. You don't want that. And the other thing is that you enter and exit the subdivided guy, again, at the acute angle. And then this is going to work. So let's see that path. It's crazier and crazier and crazier. Gets a little hard to see when it gets very small. So now there's sort of an artistic problem. How do I show this on a static image that's printed on a piece of glass that's hanging up in a mathematics department? It's all very well to sort of animate this with slides, but how do I show this? So first of all, I'm going to use 2 triangles because the panel's rectangular, and having just one triangle there seems like a bit of a waste. And let's subdivide, and so I'm also, rather than drawing a curve for this curve, I'm going to fill it in because now it's closed. So now I've got an inside and an outside. And I'm going to subdivide, and I'm going to subdivide again. And on the left, I've got just what's happening as I'm subdividing and I'm changing this curve. On the right is what's going to build the design itself. So what I want to do is I want to show on a static image all of these different levels of subdivision. And so that's what's happening here, is on the left, I've continued to subdivide everything, and on the right, I've left these the same. I've left these constants. So these aren't going to change and I'm just going to change what's happening everywhere else to show how the curve develops and gets more complicated. So I wanted to start out simple at the top left and get more complicated as I go down to the bottom right. So, here's the rule. I've got this big triangle here. Sorry for the squigglies, I'm not quite sure what's going on with the projector. I've got this big triangle up here, and this, and it's subdivided into five triangles. One here, two here, three here, four here, and five here. So the rule is, I leave the first triangle alone. Well, let's go to the next one. So I leave the first triangle, and then the next four get subdivided. And now we go to the fourth triangle, one, two, three, four, and then I do the same thing. I'm going to leave the first triangle alone, and then the rest of them get subdivided. And then one, two, three, four, I'm going to leave the first triangle alone, and the others get subdivided. One, two, three, four. First triangle is going to stay the same. I better get this right because I'm pointing at it. And the others get subdivided. And it's the same thing on the other side, just the ordering of the triangles is different, but you're still simplest up here and getting more complicated as we go down. And so this shows all these different steps of this subdivision getting more complicated, but on a static image. There's one more thing to do, which is there's all of these big black lines. So I have to have the thickness of the lines change as you go down, because you have to have big, thick lines for the biggest picture, otherwise they'd be invisibly thin. But then you zoom in and you look at this thing here, and it's all covered with these enormous black lines. So the next thing to do is have the blackness fade out as you go down into the corner, and that's the design. So that's how this came about, and that's the mathematics behind it. So that was sort of one talk of three, and I've taken about 17 minutes. I think I'm doing all right. It's okay. The second talk's very short. Oh, wait. There's more stuff. Other things you can do with this tiling. So now I've got this interesting curve. I can make other designs with it. These are just not doing these subdivision and not doing these sort of animations, just stopping at a particular point. This is all of the curves at once. It's sort of a scary picture. You can see that this is the second level curve here, and they're all sort of overlaid on top of each other. Same thing, but with the different colors showing the different. It could have been this. Be glad that you got what you got. rainbow mess. Here's another sort of scary version of this. This is sort of starting out with the simple curve and then getting more complicated with the same curve, but doesn't really look as good as the final design, I don't think. There's other things you can do with other kinds of curves. This is one based on a subdivision, a different subdivision of squares, not the Hilbert curve. Different thing you can do. And some things based on triangles, and that's a nice design. I wonder where you've seen that before. Other things you can do. Here's one based on that original Tetris one. You can do the same sort of thing with the Tetris piece, finding a curve that goes through here. It's a little bit more complicated. You have to do quite a few more cases to get it to work. Okay, second talk. This is joint work with Jeffrey Irving, who's a programmer who lives in San Francisco. So this is another sort of thing that we can do with these fractal curves, but this time to make sculpture. So I'm not really going to say much about 3D printing other than to say it lets me do cool stuff. You can ask me about the technology if you want afterwards. So here's another fractal curve. I guess I showed this on a slide before. This is called the Ter-Dragon curve. So here's the idea. So I've got this sequence of curves, and again, I've got this problem that I want to show this process, but in a static object. So rather than animating on a screen, I can arrange these curves in space. So the simplest curve is at the top, that's just the straight line. And then a little bit further down, there's a zigzag. It's all sort of smoothed out, because you don't want nasty sharp angles. So I've got a zigzag a little bit further down, and then a little bit further down, there's a more complicated zigzag, and you keep going. in a sense, there's not a lot more to say. It's just there's some annoying technical details of how to actually produce these things, but that's the idea, is have these, here are some of the, not that exact design. I'll show some pictures of these, and you can have a look at these. Actually, maybe I'll hand these around, so you can have a look. It starts out simple at the top, and then it gets progressively more and more complicated as you go down. And don't worry too much about breaking them. Survived Delta, so you should be fine. So this was an art show that I did at Stony Brook University with a different collaborator of mine, Saul Schleimer. So we had this large, this is about this big, and it was hanging above a mirror, so you could sort of look down and see the underside. So you could see the interesting curve and also see the surface. Here's one of the ones that I'm handing around. This is based on the Hilbert curve. So again, it starts with that, just three sides of a square, and then it gets progressively squigglier as you go down and down and down. This one's called the Sierpinski arrowhead curve. So you may recognize, I mean, this looks pretty similar to the Sierpinski triangle that I showed you before, so this is a curve that goes through those points rather than is the Sierpinski triangle itself. One of the interesting things about doing mathematical art is that people, you know, sometimes ascribe some sort of emotional content to this. And I'm just saying, well, that's just how the math is. You can read whatever you want into it. One of the things here is once you've seen the faces in this, it's impossible to unsee. It's these robot troopers from Star Wars or something with the two eyes and the nostrils and so on. But yeah, the face is all over that one if you spot them. This is based on the dragon curve. Somebody described this as an office block going for a walk. Sort of decided to take off at some point. So anyway, it's great. But yeah, it's just the dragon curve. I mean, that's just, you know, what the thing is. And this was a render of the dragon curve again, which was made by Jeffrey Irving. So this is almost the same design as this. It doesn't have windows, and it's sort of smooth in a slightly different way. What's really interesting about what's going on here is the coloring. So many of you may be familiar with the idea of similarity. So similar triangles are triangles which you're allowed to rotate and scale and move, but you're not allowed to sort of shear or change the angles of the triangle. So this is colored by similarity. So these different patches, you see these sort of bright pink patches here, they're similar to each other. So you scale down and rotate around and scale down and rotate around, but it's the same shape otherwise. And there's all of these patterns of similarity between the different patches of the surface. So there's some sort of self-similar fractal thing going on in this sequence of curves, and this is showing it again in the extruded, developed version. Okay, halfway through-ish, and I've got one more talk, but there's some stuff that I have to explain. So this is stereographic projection in the fourth dimension. So this is joint work with Vi Hart, who you may know from her YouTube videos. She has many, many more views than I do. And my brother, Will Segerman. And I'm going to hopefully explain what is going on with this sculpture, which has eight monkeys. So let me hand that around as well. This is called More Fun Than a Hypercube of Monkeys. And I need to play the animation for a little bit. So let me just try and... So this is a print of something that really lives in four dimensions. But this is projected into three dimensions so that we can look at it. It's maybe a little bit dusty from the printing process. So there are eight monkeys. I don't know if you can see them here. There are two rings of monkeys. One of them is in this animation cycling around in a circle this way, and there's another ring of four monkeys that are cycling around in a circle this way. So let me try and explain what is going on with this sculpture in the next 21 minutes. So first of all, I need to tell you about stereographic projection. Can we get the lights down? So kill them all. Nope, wrong way. Yes, there we go. So, so here's a, well, you see it on the screen. Here's this model. It's sort of a pattern on a sphere. And if I put the light in just the right place, then the pattern on the sphere, these sort of curvy rectangles, becomes a perfect square grid. It's just difficult to do, but you get the idea. Maybe if I hold it here, I can do this better. Anyway, I set it up perfectly for the shot. So I should mention there's a cheat here, just because. So why not? So this is a difficult photograph to get. This is actually taped onto a rod that's hanging from something up above. So I could position it in exactly the right place and then just put my hand in the right place to take the photograph. But anyway, it looks good. Looks like I'm very skillful at putting it in the right place. Anyway, so what is stereographic projection? It's a map. It's a function that takes a point on the sphere to a point on the plane. And so when I say map, you should be really thinking of maps, you know, like the Mercator projection, the map of the world. And so, you know, the usual issue with drawing a map of the world is spherical, but you want to draw it on a flat plane, and you get all of these distortions. So Greenland looks way too big, looks like it's the same size as Africa, although in reality, Greenland is 10 times smaller than Africa. So you get these sort of distortions. So this is trying to do the same thing. It's trying to map from the sphere to the plane, but it's done with the light rays. So how does this work? So here's what the map is. There's a light source up at the north pole of the sphere, and then the light sort of draws straight lines which hit the sphere and hit the plane. And the map is map that point on the sphere to the plane. So what happens is the light ray comes along, and maybe it hits the plastic and maybe it doesn't. And let's suppose that it doesn't, then it carries on through and it hits the plane. And so this light trick does stereographic projection. It maps the pattern on the sphere onto the plane. And so this has some distortion as well. Any kind of map like this has to have some distortion. So for example, you can see on the plane it's a nice regular grid, but on the sphere the same grid is distorted a little bit, and you can see that the squares are getting smaller. So if I could continue this up nearer and nearer to the North Pole, those squares would get smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. Here's a few other beautiful pictures of stereographic projection. Let me just do this one maybe. So this one up in the top right. So the pattern is this pattern of circles arranged over the sphere. It turns out these are arranged as the faces of a dodecahedron and the faces of an icosahedron, if you're familiar with those. And so if I can just hold it in the right place, you see this projection on here. And let me just mention one of there's a few amazing properties that stereographic projection has. So one is that it preserves angles. So what do I mean by this? Let me just step back to here. So you see all of these, there's all of these right angles between the grid here on the plane. You get the same right angles between these curves on the sphere. So I mean, the curves are curving, but where they meet at right angles. So those angles on the sphere get mapped forward to angles on the plane. And you can see that here as well. This one, there's all of these, this is done with perspectives, but as inhabitants of the third dimension, you know how perspective works, and you can see that these angles here are obviously all 60 degrees each, and just as they are up here on the model. So one further amazing feature that this has, not only does it preserve angles, it also preserves circles. So you see all of these circles, well, they should be circles. Let's see if I can put it in the right place. There's all of these circles on the plane that are mapped there from circles on the sphere. But there's something a little strange going on. Because, let's see, so it knows that circles go to circles, but it doesn't know where their centers go. This is sort of difficult because I don't have enough hands to point at things. But if you look at this circle in the top right, you'll notice that it's got this sort of spiky pentagon in the middle, right? And, but the center of the spiky pentagon is not at the center of the circle. whereas on the model itself, the center of the spiky pentagon is it at the center of the circle. So it knows where circles go, but it doesn't know where the centers go. It's very, very strange. Anyway, so stereographic projection is a map which takes something on the sphere to something on the plane. So suppose that you had a two-dimensional friend, and you wanted to explain to her what a cube is. As a three-dimensional person, you know what a cube is, because you know what's happening next, is that I've got a three-dimensional friend, and I want to explain what a four-dimensional hypercube is. So get ready, because we're going up a dimension soon. So one thing you could do is you could cast a shadow of this cube. I should have a cube with me, apparently I don't. I could cast a shadow of this cube into the plane, and then she would be able to look at this shadow and understand what's going on. It's a bit complicated. And it's got, I'm not going to talk about everything on this table, by the way. We'll just have to come up to me and find out what these are. It's too complicated. So there's this idea of projecting things down. Here's my favorite way to show my two-dimensional friend what a cube looks like. I want to use stereographic projection. It has all these beautiful properties. But I've got this cube which isn't sitting on a sphere. So I need to map from the sphere to the plane. That's what stereographic projection does. So I need to get the cube onto the sphere. So the first thing I do is I'm going to blow this cube up into a roundy beach ball cube. So that's sort of the idea of what's going on here. I've got a light source in here in the middle of the cube, and it's casting shadows onto this sort of curvy cube on the outside. And over here is sort of an animation of just expanding the cube into a curvy cube. Now it's on the sphere. Now I can do stereographic projection. And so here's this sort of curved beach ball cube, and here's the projection onto the plane. And so again, this preserves angles. You've got these 120 degree angles up here, and it's a little hard to see, but these curves on the plane are 120 degrees as well. So as promised, how do we show a hypercube to a three-dimensional friend, say all of you people here who came to my talk? First of all, what is a hypercube? Hold on, let's take a step back. Let me build a hypercube and start with something very simple. So I'm going to start with a point. I'm going to move it to the side, make another copy of it, and then draw a line segment between them and get a line. And then I'm going to do the same thing again. I'm going to take a line segment, I'm going to take a copy, move it to the side, draw some extra lines between them, and I'm going to get a square. Then I'm going to do the same thing again. Take the square, move it to the side, draw lines between them, and get a cube. Everybody happy so far? All right, next. Take a cube, move it to the side, draw all of the lines between the corners, and we get a hypercube. So this is some sort of picture of what's going on. It's a little difficult to tell what is in fact happening. But anyway, if you do this whole thing again, the project out onto the sphere, and then stereographically project down to the plane, except everything is up a dimension. So now we're projecting out onto the sphere in four-dimensional space, whatever that is. And then stereographic projection goes from the sphere in four-dimensional space to the three-dimensional space, which is where we live, which is why I can 3D print this thing. So I can't show you the intermediate stages like I showed you for the cube going to the roundy cube going to the plane, but I can show you the result, and that's what the hypercube looks like. Here's another picture, and you can see, one of the features of the hypercube is that it's got eight cubical faces. So just as the cube has six square faces, and the square has four line sides, and the line has two point ends, so two ends, four sides, six faces, eight hyperfaces, I guess. So here they are. There's one in the middle. There's six arranged around them, six sort of distorted trapezium-style cubes. That's seven. And then there's one outside that we're standing inside of. So getting there. Where's that hypercube of monkeys? All right, so we know what projection is, and we know what a hypercube is. I need to tell you what symmetry is. So a symmetry of an object is a motion that leaves the object looking the same. So here's a design, and I can rotate this Right? I can rotate this by a fifth of a turn or two-fifths of a turn. In fact, there are five symmetries of this thing. I can rotate by one-fifth, two-fifths, three-fifths, four-fifths, and I include the do-nothing motion as well. So there are five symmetries of this thing. And you can add these together, right? I can do one-fifth turn, and then I can do a two-fifth turn, and now I put those together, and I get the same thing as doing three-fifths turn. So I've got this sort of way that these can interact. Here's another design. How many symmetries does this have? I should ask questions to be interactive. People who don't have a PhD in mathematics. Seven? Eight? Somebody said eight. So you're probably not thinking of the do-nothing symmetry as well. There are four rotations. I can rotate this by 90 degrees, 180 degrees, 270 degrees, or do nothing. Or I can reflect it across these four axes. So there are eight symmetries here. Okay, now I need to talk about monkey blocks. So what we're getting towards, what this sculpture is about, is a symmetry which doesn't exist in three dimensions. You have to go to four dimensions to see this symmetry and then project it down to three-dimensional space, and that's what the monkeys are about. So I'm going to try and explain in the next 9 minutes, what this symmetry is in four-dimensional space. So we've got these blocks, and they've got these designs on these. These are Weihart's designs. You may recognize her drawing. So there are two monkey faces, one on each side. There are two monkey paws, and there are two monkey tails. And these are you fold these up into to look like this cube. And so you can ask, how do these monkey blocks fit together so that the faces match? So unfortunately, I don't have time to sort of have you play about with paper monkey blocks and see how these go, so I'm just going to have to sort of show you what happens. So you can stack these monkey blocks sort of paw to paw. But the way that they're arranged, you sort of have to twist as you go along. So you can see that there's this left monkey paw over here. If I go back a step, you see there's a left monkey paw on the far side, and there's a right monkey paw on the near side. So when you stack these together so that they match, you have to sort of rotate them as you go along. So that's what's going on here. And so we can ask, what are the symmetries of this infinite line? So if I stack infinitely many of them, what is a motion of this line of cubes with patterns on them that leaves it looking the same? Right? Just like rotation of this design left it looking the same. And so what you can do is, well, so you can shift the whole thing forward four blocks, right? You can see this monkey tail will match up with that monkey tail, and this face will match up with that face. If I just move the whole thing forward four blocks, that makes sense? Or even better, I can go forward twisting left as I go. Let's see, yes. So I go forward one step, and I rotate one click to the left. All right, well, let's wrap four of these around into a circle and see what happens with those. So this is the same sort of thing, except that I'm not really bothering with the go forward by four. Now, go forward by four is the do-nothing symmetry, but I still have the go forward one and rotate one click around. So I get this sort of twisting symmetries of these sort of rings of blocks. So what next? What else can you make with these things? So it turns out, so you can make this infinite line, but if you try and stack these into a wall, it doesn't work. And the reason is, well, let's just go to the next picture. So here's three of them in a line, you can't really see them, but if you put one of them above here, then there's nothing that you can put in this fourth corner of those three, because there's two monkey paws there. There's no, you don't see that on the block, so it doesn't work. Some of you may already have realized what's about to happen. If only I could glue these two monkey paws together, then it would all work nicely. It would stack together with itself. And you can't do that with actual blocks in Euclidean space, but you can do that with the hypercube. Somebody saw this coming already. So here's this picture of the hypercube. It turns out that so there's a cube up here, a cube down here, and a cube over here, and there's three cubes arranged around this edge. So the angle at those edges is somehow 120 degrees, rather than what you would expect. Eight of these monkey blocks glue together to make the cells, the hyperfaces of a hypercube. Okay, so what are the symmetries of this thing? So we have this ring of four blocks, and we have these things twisting around. except now that we've got them twisting in three different axes, along each axis there are two rings of them that are rotating around together as you go. It's all a bit complicated. Let me just have one slide with some math notation, because it's really cool. So these decorated hypercubes, so I've got this hypercube, and each cube has these monkey block decorations in them. And the symmetries of this, that it turns out there are eight symmetries of this, and these correspond to the eight elements of something called the quaternion group, which has, it has these eight elements. One is the do-nothing element. I, J, and K are these sort of screw motions, where you go forward one and you click around, but I, J, and K are in three different directions. And then the reverse screw motions, and then there's the square of any of most of the elements is minus one, which sends a cube to its opposite. Anyway, so there's this symmetry, Q8. It doesn't exist in three-dimensional space. There's no artwork, polyhedron, anything that has this symmetry. It turns out because it's just not a subgroup of SO3, whatever that means. But it is very naturally a symmetry of the hypercube, this four-dimensional thing. So to make a sculpture which has the symmetry, we have to make it in four-dimensional space, and then we have to project it down. So that's what this thing is. So I need this pattern in each of the eight cells, which has no symmetry, or rather only the do-nothing symmetry. And so what I need to do is put a design inside of this cube, which has no symmetry. And if you're a mathematical artist and you need to make up a design that has no symmetry, there's really no choice. It has to be a monkey. In fact, it had to be a monkey for this because it had to connect through the six faces of the cube to its neighbors. And monkeys have six limbs if you include the head and the tail. So then we move this around to all of the other eight cubes. So they're the neighbors of this monkey. And the monkey's standing on its own head and it's grabbing hold of a paw and it's grabbing hold of a tail. And then we can, again, do this four-dimensional stereographic projection thing and put it down into space, and then we can 3D print a model. Let me just show this animation again of what's happening. So what this is the model is being rotated in four dimensions before it gets projected down into three dimensions. And so you're seeing a symmetry of this because, so as it's rotating around here, a quarter of a turn, and you see it twisting as well, a quarter of a turn with the twist takes it back to where it was before. So this is showing one of the symmetries of this sculpture. Okay, I think I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Questions for Greg?
Wow.
So people have thought about the question of what shape is the universe from a sort of three-dimensional manifold point of view. I think people have done very interesting sort of research looking at, if you look out into the sky, can you see the same galaxy from two different directions? Can you work out the connectivity of the universe based on what it looks like? And as far as I know, the latest data is that the universe is a little too big. We can't see far enough. It's a little bit inconclusive. But there's certainly interesting questions there. Can we discover the shape of the universe, which it has some relations to these sorts of ideas? Yeah?
With respect to the art, yes. Has there been any attempt to do different sonifications of some of these?
Different sonifications? I'm not sure what a sonification is.
Well, the idea is essentially that you're trying to create music.
Oh, right.
Out of either the geometry or whatever.
Oh, right.
And so I was just wondering, with your design on the right, if there'd be some interesting way to do a sonification of that.
Right.
So to add the music, if you could.
Yeah. Right? So what I can tell you, the mathematics and the arts community is really growing. There's annual conferences, there's journals and so on. And there is quite a bit of activity in mathematical art. If you've been to the Museum of Mathematics in New York City, they have, it's not exactly this, but but they have work by Dmitry Timoshkov. Yes, thank you. And he's looking at arranging possible chords in space according to some manifold. So, I mean, there's certainly connection. I don't know that people have done many things. No, surely people have done things with fractals in music. But you sort of get the same problem with 3D printing. You can only go so far before you run into problems of it getting too small. And I assume it's the same issue in music as well. So I don't know that anybody's done anything in particular with the pinwheel time. The translation from, meaning clearly it's a two-dimensional geometric idea, but translating that in an accurate way into one-dimensional audio is a difficult problem. But I'd be very interested to hear somebody figure something out.
Yes. Yeah. So for these reptiling, when you create a curve, are you picking particularly nice reptiling, or do you actually know how to characterize which reptilings will have this kind of self-repeating?
I don't know how to do that.
Well, and the rules are not precisely. I mean, as putting on my artist hat, it's like, well, whatever works and gets a nice picture. So I haven't. So right, I mean, I've looked at these different reptiles. So for example, let's see if I can go back to so many slides. This one. So this is the nicest curve that I could find on this L-shape reptile, and it's not very nice. You have to have three or four different constructions for different kinds of things that come up before it starts becoming self-contained. So do you allow that when you're trying to come up with something?
Well, I'd be interested, like, if you can start thinking about reptiling and so on, have genus of a reptiling based
on
how many, designs you need to be able to do a curve.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know that it's really been formally explored. I think it may be kind of messy. I mean, you have to decide what the rules are and then look for it. But yeah, I don't know. It's a good question.
Yeah. I'm curious about the 3D printing, how you use those models.
There's a company based in New York, and you upload your design to them, and you hit buy, and then it arrives in the mail 2 weeks later. I mean, I can tell you more about how they're made. I mean, so there's different technologies that all called 3D printing. Some of them are, so the ones that you're likely to sort of buy as a consumer are sort of more or less a glorified glue gun. There's a precisely controlled robot arm that squirts down melted plastic and builds up a shape.
So it would come out as that shape, not a one-dimensional paper that then...
Right, no, it comes out as this. The way that these are made is slightly different. You've got sort of layers of plastic dust in a machine. It's heated up just below the melting point, and then a laser melts it where it wants to be solid. Another layer of plastic dust, zap, another layer of plastic dust, zap. And at the end, you have this vat full of dust, and you hoover all of the unused material out, and you get your thing.
So how do you upload the design?
So there's a file format. It's a closed, well, so the standard thing would be you give it a triangulated surface, and that tells it what's inside and should be made of plastic and what's outside and should not be made of plastic. And so this is just a standard format.
All right, looks like I'm ready to go.